Are you interested in learning how to make cyanotypes? Stay tuned. In this video, we're going to walk through the process and materials, and we'll go end to end through the entire process. And if you follow along, you'll end up with a print by the end. If you're not familiar with what a cyanotype is, here's a quick example of a few that I've done over the years when I'm testing different ways of creating negatives. It's just a really brief example of what you can do. This is a pretty versatile medium, and there's a lot of creativity and a lot of ways to approach it. But we'll cover hand-drawn and photographic negatives in the second part of this video. We're actually going to break it up into two videos. This was getting a little long as I was recording it. So in this video, we're going to cover tools, materials, and the coating of the paper and storage of paper. And then in the second week's video, we're going to cover exposing a negative and how to create those negatives, both through a hand-drawn process and through a photographic process. Once I post the second video, I will leave a link to it down in the description below. Hi, my name's Jeff. I'm an artist, photographer, and videographer. And cyanotypes have been a part of my art practice for years now. I've been fortunate to be able to exhibit them. I've done both group shows and a couple solo shows with cyanotypes. They seem to be really well received, both in the fine art world, and I enjoyed, just when I was learning the process, doing it more as a hobby until I became good enough at it to show it professionally. So it's a fun process. It's relatively fast as printmaking processes go, and I think you're going to enjoy it. You will need some materials and equipment to make cyanotypes. It's a relatively approachable process. There are far more expensive printmaking processes and photographic processes. This is one that's fairly affordable. And we'll run through that in a second. We'll go down to my studio and I'll do a top-down shot of one of my workbenches and walk you through all the materials. Before I get there though, like all art processes, you do not want to mix this stuff. You don't want to ingest this. So anything that gets used for cyanotypes or any other art process, never use in food preparation. We need to measure some liquids here. It needs to be in a dedicated thing that's stored away from anywhere you could mistake it for a food prep item. This isn't the most toxic of printmaking processes by far, and certainly not for photographic processes. There's a lot of nasty chemicals in some of the alternative photo stuff. That said, I certainly don't want to ingest it. So be safe. You can download the safety data sheet for the kit that I'm going to show you, and I imagine most other places that produce kits will have a safety data sheet. It's worth reading them. They're a little dry, but it shows you what to do in case you're accidentally exposed to it directly or spill it. It'll tell you whether things are flammable or hazardous in any way. It's just a good idea to research those. You can Google them. I did before I started this video, and it got me right to the website of the manufacturer, and it had a great document. And when you're done going through this, you don't have to worry about writing everything down. I will post a list in the description of everything you need. To make cyanotypes, you are going to need some materials. First, you'll need some cyanotype chemistry. It's a two-part mixture of potassium ferricyanide and ferric ammonium citrate. I got this kit at a local art store, and it's available online as well. The kit has the chemicals pre-measured for you, which makes getting started a lot easier. Second, I recommend wearing nitrile gloves. These chemicals will stain your hands, clothes, work surfaces, and anything else it comes in contact with. It's a good idea to protect anything that you don't want turning blue. Next, you'll need some paper to make the prints. I've used printmaking paper, watercolor paper, and cotton fabric successfully. This is cheap watercolor paper that I got at a local art store, and it works great for getting started. Once you get some prints done, you may want to experiment with different papers as they do impact the final image a little bit. You will need some kind of artwork to make the print. Cyanotype is a negative process, so remember that areas that are dark in your artwork are going to be light in the final print and vice versa. The artwork has to be on some medium that will allow light to pass through. I've used acetate, acetate alternatives, and clear plastic that's used for making negatives for screen printing. I've used them all successfully. You can get a lot of those online. Some of them you can get at art stores depending on how well stocked they are. Another thing to remember as you're creating the artwork is remember that the image will be flipped left to right as well. Darks become lights and left to right gets flipped. You can also use 3D objects to use cyanotypes. I've seen some great prints made using dried plants and things like that. For small prints like these, cheap clip frames work really well. I got this one at a local hobby store. It comes with a sheet of glass, a backing board, and then four metal clips, which I lost. If, like me, you lose the clips that came with your frame, it's not a big deal. I went and got these cheap spring clamps, and they work great. Even when I'm wearing clothes I don't care about staining, I like to wear an apron to protect my clothing. I also try to protect work tables by taping one of these 55-gallon plastic garbage bags down over the top. There are a few ways to get the chemistry onto the paper. I like to use these cheap foam brushes. You need to avoid anything that uses metal. Cyanotype chemistry can react badly to some kinds of metal. To hold the mixed chemistry, I use a recycled yogurt cup. Anything like that is going to work. Just clean it out really well. Get a container that is dedicated to this process. You don't want to use anything that will ever be used for food. I store this with my other supplies in my art studio, so it's way away from any kind of food, but it's not a bad idea to mark the outside with something to remind you this isn't a yogurt cup anymore, it's something for this specific chemistry. Hydrogen peroxide can be used when we're developing the prints in the next video to darken the final print. The prints will do that on their own over time, so this isn't absolutely necessary, but it's kind of fun to watch it darken up in a couple of seconds in the final bath. I use a photo washout tank, this one's extremely dusty, to rinse out my prints. A developing tray works just as well, and it's a little cheaper, or you could probably find a shallow tray. If it has really vertical sides and is deep, it's kind of a pain to get your print in and out, but other than that, pretty much anything that's going to hold water will work just fine. Again, use something that you don't care about staining. Make sure the tray that you're going to use to wash out the prints is smaller than your sink and larger than your prints. I made that mistake and bought a larger tray that I thought would fit, and it ended up being a few centimeters or a couple inches larger than my sink. And a graduated cylinder or a measuring cup, you can use the ones that are designed for measuring liquids for the kitchen. And again, you're going to want to mark it if you do that. These graduated cylinders are really cheap online, so that's what I got, and they're very accurate. And finally, the chemicals come as a dry powder, and I use distilled water to mix them up. I'm not sure whether my tap water has anything that would cause problems or not, but distilled water is cheap insurance to make sure I don't make a mistake and ruin a project. You will need a source of ultraviolet light as well to expose these prints. The sun is the easy one. If you live in a place that gets regular sun and you have a place where you can set something outside, that is by far the cheapest way to do this. I've got a black light setup that I use when I can't go outside. I'll show you that in part two of this video. A couple of things that I forgot to show you in the video but that are handy. One, you need a place to store these in the dark. I've used cardboard boxes in the past, something that I got from an online purchase, and then just recycled it, stacked the coated papers inside of that, and then wrapped it in black fabric or a black plastic bag or both, and then put it in a closet that doesn't have any light. I currently use a archival box made out of cotton fiber that doesn't cause harm to the paper if you store it in there for a long time. And I still wrap that in black plastic and black fabric to protect it from light. And finally, something that most people have, having paper towels around to clean up any spills. I keep them near me because if you spill, you don't want this getting very far. As I mentioned before, it will stain a lot of surfaces, so having paper towels around is a great idea. Once you have your materials together, get the Cyanotype bottles out of their kit and read through the instructions. The kit that I bought, you just needed to pour in some clean water and let it sit for a day to mix. I use distilled water. I'm not sure if there's anything in my water that would cause a problem, but distilled water is cheap, so that's what I use to hydrate the chemistry. And then just give it a couple of turns to make sure it's well mixed and let it sit for 24 hours. So in the next part of this video, we're gonna go back down into my studio, and this time the lights are really dim. I usually coat paper in a room that has either safe lights or a really dim incandescent light because this is sensitive to any ultraviolet light, and a lot of modern LEDs put off UV. Not a ton, but I just don't want to risk ruining a project because I wasn't careful with light. This time I'll coat with a little bit more light on so you can see what I'm doing, but it's still going to be a little bit underexposed, so I apologize for that ahead of time, and please bear with me and I'll walk through the process. With the chemicals that you need mixed up at least a day ahead of time, we're going to mix these two solutions together in equal amounts. It doesn't take much of this solution for these small prints, so don't go too heavy with the mixing. I've used a little masking tape and the bag that I showed earlier to cover my work table so we don't stain it. And through all of these steps, I'm wearing nitrile gloves and a shop apron to protect my hands and clothes. I'm mixing 30 cc's of these. Watching it later, I probably should have gone a little less. I had plenty of extra and ended up coating quite a few extra pieces of paper after I stopped the video. Once the chemistry is mixed, it doesn't have a terribly long shelf life. I think I read it's about 24 hours. I usually use it within a few hours of mixing the chemistry together. So mixing less doesn't create a problem because you can always mix a little bit more, but you can't put it back into the bottle. So go smaller than you think if you're not used to the process. As I'm mixing these in the room, the first chemical looks green in the dim light as I pour it into the graduated cylinder. Did a little of this off camera. Sorry about that. We'll show it here in just a second. Make sure you cap the bottles right away to avoid spills. It's really easy to knock these over, and a bottle full of chemistry looks small on the table and looks large when it's poured out all over the floor. Again, off screen, I poured 30 cc's of chemical A into the recycled yogurt tub. Now I'm going to add 30 cc's more, this time of chemical B, into the graduated cylinder. And like the first one, this looks green in the dim light. Either stir or swirl these chemicals together. I just use the brush that I'm going to use for coating. I find that these foam brushes take a bit of work to get them loaded the first time, so I press it against the bottom and then the sides of the container to load and unload it a few times just to make sure it's absorbing the liquid well. Now I'll put the container to one side, making sure I've got room for the paper next to it. I'm right-handed, so I put it on the left, so I'm not going over it as I'm trying to coat. A little less chance of knocking it over. This is a sheet of the inexpensive watercolor paper I showed earlier. I usually tear out all of the sheets that I'm planning on coating before I even get started, so I don't accidentally get chemistry. It's easy to get it on your hands, and then you get it on the paper in spots that you don't want it. As you paint the solution on, it'll look streaky at first. I change directions with lighter and lighter pressure until there are no streaks. With larger or more absorbent paper, you may need to reload the brush to get enough chemistry on the page. This paper, like most papers, are going to curl when you paint the chemistry on and then flatten back out as they dry. You could tape down the corners to avoid that if you wanted to. I often do, but since I needed to move stuff around for the video, I didn't do that this time. It's not going to be a problem. They will flatten back out. With the second page, we're going to repeat the process again. The page is slightly bowed right out of the pad. I just noticed that, so I decided to put the page convex side up. Probably not very important, but it made sense when I was filming this. You can paint to the edges if you prefer, if you want the whole thing blue. I find it makes a little bit more of a mess. It's easy to paint over onto the table, and then you get the chemistry on the back. And I don't know that that causes a problem, but annoys me as a printmaker. I had teachers that would lower my grade if I got ink on the backs of paper. So if I'm in a hurry or just trying not to make a mess, I'll leave the brush strokes on there. I think it looks neat for these kinds of prints. There are other ways to coat paper, including using a special glass rod to get a very even coat. And that makes a lot of sense if you're doing expensive photo printing methods like platinum prints, but I find it's a little expensive and unnecessary for this process. This one bowed up pretty dramatically, but it will flatten out as it dries. Again, we're going to do the exact same process for the third. We're going to use light pressure until the streaks disappear. As I coat this last piece, I'll mention that if you have a small table or you're coating multiple large pieces of paper, you might want to set some large pieces of cardboard on the ground away from where you're coating. That'll give you a place to let them dry without as much risk of staining the floor. I do printmaking and painting in the studio as well, so the floor is kind of a mess, but I do try to avoid making it any worse. unless you never get things shipped to you from online, I would avoid biting cardboard. You can just recycle boxes that other projects or other things came in. I've got a whole stack of cardboard in my studio for just this purpose. I currently store my coated paper, after they dry, in an archival cardboard storage box that is made out of cotton fibers. I wrap that in a black plastic bag and then cover it in black fabric. Looking back at these, as I mentioned before, these that are still curved will flatten back out as they dry. Time to clean up the tub, brush, and graduated cylinder. I've got a utility sink in my studio that I use for cleaning. Avoid using your kitchen sink. Again, you don't want to contaminate your food with this chemistry. And make sure you rinse the tub really well when you're done to make sure it doesn't stain. I rinse everything a few times in the sink, and then the final rinse I do with some distilled water so I don't leave any chemicals from the tap water in it, and then I leave them to dry. So once you have the paper coated, you need to turn off the light and let it dry in the dark. I usually give mine at least a couple hours, assuming it's not super humid outside. If it is really humid, you might need to let yours rest a little bit longer. Also, super absorbent papers, things like fabric, tend to take a little bit longer to dry. So test it, make sure it's not wet before you stack them together because they can stick, and then let them dry and get them into a dark box. I'm going to end there for the week. Next week, we'll cover everything from creating the negatives, both hand-drawn and photographic, to the final print, walking you through the. If you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe. I post videos on art, photo, and video topics, as well as some inspiration for artists and creatives. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comments, and we'll see you next time.